Es ist Donnerstag, der 15. August 2013. Hier ist die Sendung Macht und Menschenrechte. Mein Name ist Volker Reusing. Guten Abend. Heute werde ich zwei Gäste in der Sendung interviewen. Als erstes werde ich gleich sprechen mit dem ecuadorianischen Wirtschaftswissenschaftler Dr. Pedro Paez. Und danach werde ich Interview führen mit dem amerikanischen Filmemacher Ace Baker. Kommen wir nun zu unserem ersten Interviewgast. Dr. Pedro Paez, we are very honored that you have found a time to give an interview to us.
Thank you very much. I'm very, very glad to have this opportunity to address to the people in Germany.
You are the president of the Superintendencia de Control de, del Poder de Mercado. When has this authority been founded, and what is its purpose?
This is the Ecuadorian equivalent to a kind of mixture between the Monopoly Commission and the Bundeskartellamt in Germany.
Die Behörde für Kontrolle der Marktmacht in Ecuador, deren Präsident der ecuadorianische Wirtschaftswissenschaftler Dr. Pedro Paez ist, ist das ecuadorianische Parlament zur Monopolkommission und zum Bundeskartellamt in Deutschland. And when has your authority been founded?
It's a very recent institution. It came out of the constitutional process that started in 2007. It is in the new constitution in 2008, and it was inaugurated in September 6, 2012.
Es ist entstanden, die Behörde, aus dem Verfassungsprozess 2007. Die neue Verfassung stammt von 2008 und die Behörde ist sehr neu, ist im September 2012 gegründet worden.
So it's a brand new institution, and this is very significant because basically we are dealing with all the traditional normative, anti-monopoly normative of the rest of Latin America, and very close to the legislation in Europe. And even though we have just now, for the first time, the domestic normative and an institution in charge of making real the new realm of rights that the organic law of regulation allow to the consumer, to the citizen, to the other enterprise to exercise.
Ja, was auch neu ist in der Behörde, ist, dass sie sich außer gegen Monopole wendet, auch sich um Verbraucherschutz kümmert. Which work do you do for the protection of the consumers?
Yeah, we have a kind of juxtaposition between the consumers protection law in charge of the ombudsman. There is another institution called ombudsman in Ecuador, la Defensoría del Pueblo, and our law that is specifically related to market power abuses, specifically related to higher prices, restriction of supply, a restriction in terms of quality, problems of unloyal competition, and that could create some problems, but we are in very good terms, with a very fluid conversation with the other institutions in order to create new conditions, the new rules of the game in favor of the population in Ecuador.
Gibt es für den Verbraucherschutz, gibt es einen Ansprechpartner, einen Ombudsmann für den Verbraucherschutz, und die Anti-Monopol Behörde arbeitet sehr gut mit dem zusammen. Die Aufgabe der Behörde von Dr. Faiz ist, gegen den Missbrauch von Marktmacht vorzugehen. Das kann überhöhte Preise betreffen, das kann sich auf Qualität, es kann sich auf die künstliche Schaffung von Versorgungsengpässen beziehen oder auch auf Arten von unfairem Wettbewerb. How do you measure when a corporation has too much market power? By which figures do you measure this?
This is a challenge. We had so far produced 400 studies of sectoral concentration of power, market concentration with the traditional indexes. And in the 400 sectors, we have evidence of too much concentration. In the domestic legislation, we had to distinguish between the structure and the behavior, the performance. We do not have any instrument, any legal instrument to act upon the structure, like in the American legislation. The United States had the possibility of splitting a company, like in the case of Standard Oil, or the more recent one, the Bell, the Telefonic. In the case of the Ecuadorian legislation, we do not have any type of attributions on that realm, and we have to focus exclusively in the performance, the abuses of this market power. So basically, we have an overwhelming evidence of this type of abuses in terms of prices, in terms of quality, in terms of restrictions, supply restrictions. Those are the most generalized ones. But the problem is that the type of evidence, the type of economic evidence that we can produce is not directly available in terms of legal consequences. And our challenge and our task now is precisely to have the assertiveness in terms of the construction of a case that could end up with sanctions.
Die Behörde hat rund 400 Studien durchgeführt für verschiedene Sektoren der Wirtschaft über Machtkonzentration. Und man muss unterscheiden zwischen der Struktur von einem Konzern oder Unternehmen und zwischen dem Verhalten. Und die Superintendencia de Control del Poder de Mercado kann nur gegenüber dem Verhalten vorgehen, gegenüber dem Machtmissbrauch. Und es gibt Fälle, wo Macht missbraucht wird zu überhöhten Preisen oder auf Kosten der Qualität oder dass man die Versorgung verknappt. Aber in die Struktur eingreifen, wie das in den USA geht, wie man es bei Standard Oil gemacht hat oder im neueren Fall bei Bell, das ist nach ecuadorianischem Recht nicht möglich. How would you react if you see that a corporation has too much market shares without abusing market power?
Yeah, that is part of the chores of the inspection that we need to deploy all around the national territory. But we are much more interested in the construction of the citizens' capabilities to react by themselves before this type of abuses, instead of an approach in which penalties and fines are the main focus of our institution. Our main endeavor has been related to advocacy, conscious organization at the level of the provinces and the cities, even the most remote ones in the country. Our idea is that this is a new realm of rights, And the orientation of the new constitution is precisely the guarantee of and the deployment of rights. We need to approach the problem of the fight against the monopolies and abuses of market power, both for the internal oligarchy and the transnationals, in terms of the construction of citizenship. And the parameters are relative. We need to create a new balance of power between the citizens and the enterprises, the big enterprises, domestic or transnationals, in order to promote a new type of development, an inclusive, democratic, and sustainable development.
Es geht darum, die Bürger zu stärken, dass die Bürger ja, ihre Rechte kennen, die, dass sie informiert werden und wenn Missbrauch von Marktmacht auftritt, die Bürger es selber der Behörde melden. Es geht darum, eine Machtbalance zu schaffen. Und es geht, die Behörde kann Bußgelder, kann auch Geldstrafen festsetzen und kann tätig werden, sowohl gegenüber einheimischen Unternehmen als auch gegenüber transnationalen Unternehmen, die in Ecuador tätig sind, und geht natürlich gegen geht gegen Monopole vor, aber es geht darum, gegen den Missbrauch von Marktmacht vorzugehen. Is there any form of a special kind of control if a corporation has a very large share over a specific market, of a specific sector of the economy?
Well, we have under the scope of citizenship construction, we had deployed a very diverse and intense effort in order to create a new balance of forces. So we had, instead of focusing in one specific case, we had created a new type of citizens' mobilization in order to transform the relationship between the abuses of the enterprise, the rent-seeking strategies of the enterprise, and the new perspective of development in Ecuador. So, as I mentioned before, we have already published the indicators for 400 sectors, and we had opened the doors for agreements of cessation in order to create a new set of rules of the game instead of punishing. But at the same time, we had continued with the processing of the different infractions of the law, the violations of the law, and that has taken some time. According to the law, we have between 360 days and 480 days of the duration of the processes, including the time for the defense on behalf of the operators involved in the accusations. So we are very respectful about this situation, but once the formulation of the charges is ready, the possibility of a fine that could that is unusual in the history of Ecuador is very likely. We have up to 12% of the total sales of the enterprise, of the annual sales of the enterprise, as the top of the fine. So that has created a very how can I say, a very nervous anticipation on behalf, expectation on behalf of the businessmen, because the Ecuadorian institutionality hasn't had this type of possibilities in the past. The idea, as I mentioned, is to create another type of relationship, a new balance of power, in which the behavior and the dynamic of the dynamics of the economy could be different, related more to the incorporation of technology, a dynamics of jobs generation, a dynamics of articulation of synergies, and at the same time, a societal possibility of empowerment of the people. The most important issue here is the political issue in terms of the empowerment of the people and the construction of citizenship.
Ja, ich hatte die Frage gestellt, wie man jetzt damit umgeht, wenn jetzt ein Konzern zum Beispiel sehr große Marktanteile hat und ob es da dann eine besondere Aufsicht gibt. Und Herr Dr. Paes hat mir nochmal genauer erklärt, was der Fokus der Behörde ist. Es geht darum, die Bürger selber zu mobilisieren für ihre Rechte und es gibt ja etwa 400 Studien für 400 verschiedene Sektoren, wo Indikatoren aufgezeigt sind. Und wenn jetzt ein Unternehmen sich nicht an die Regeln hält, dann versucht man als erstes das Unternehmen dazu zu bringen, dass es dieses Verhalten einstellt und sich wieder marktgerecht verhält. Und wenn man dann Vorwürfe erheben muss gegenüber dem Unternehmen, hat es 360 bis 480 Tage Zeit. Aber die Unternehmen haben großen Respekt, denn wenn ein Bußgeld verhängt wird, dann kann es bis zu 12% des Jahresumsatzes sein. Das heißt, erst geht die Behörde kooperativ auf die Unternehmen zu, versucht eine Verhaltensänderung zu erreichen, aber wenn das nichts hilft, dann können das auch sehr, sehr harte Bußgelder sein. Und es geht ja darum, es geht natürlich um technologischen Fortschritt, es geht darum, Arbeitsplätze zu schaffen, aber es geht auch darum, die Rolle der Bürger, zu stärken.
For example, as an illustration, if I can, did you finish the translation?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, as an illustration, for example, barely 1 month our assumption of this post, in the middle of the presidential electoral campaign, the four most important banks of Ecuador sent a letter to their own depositants, their own clients, with an outrageous text saying the policy of the President of the Republic, that was at the same time candidate for re-election, is destabilizing the banking sector. So we are not responsible for the future of your savings here. So immediately, without any time, and that is very significant because it reflects the type of maximalist behavior of the and position and stance of the business class with respect to the rest of the society, and the level of blackmailing power that the different sectors of the bourgeoisie had with respect to the political and the social processes in Ecuador. So we were at that time just starting the construction, the logistic construction of the new institution, and even without any type of deep research, we intervened, showing the banking sector that we had four institutions with market power that had a simultaneous action, a collective action, with very important symptoms of coordination that could provoke a bank run that could end up in the bankruptcy of some minor institutions, some minor banks, with a consolidating processes in favor of the oligopolization of the banking sector. So that could be, that could prefigure, that could configure, that could typify an infraction of the law, because we have four market power institutions, operators, colluding, probably, in order to create further market power concentration. By itself, our intervention was enough to stop the political participation of the banks in the electoral scene, and at the same time, it created a very clear idea of which kind of changes the Ecuadorian society was undertaking.
Ein sehr prägnantes Beispiel ereignete sich während der letzten Präsidentschaftswahlen in Ecuador. Ja, die wahrscheinlich mächtigste Bank von Ecuador hat einen Text damals veröffentlicht und hat dort die Behauptung aufgestellt, dass der gegenwärtige Präsident und auch der damalige Präsident, der wiedergewählt wurde, seine Exzellenz, Herr Rafael Correa, vorgehabt habe, also dass er gegen die Banken hätte vorgehen wollen. Und das rief die Behörde auf den Plan. Sie war damals gerade noch in ihrer Aufbauphase. Und es war nicht nur eine Bank, es waren vier Banken, die in dieser Weise sich vorgegangen zu sein scheinen, wo sich die Frage stellt, ob sie das koordiniert getan haben. Vier größere Banken. Dies hätte unter Umständen eine Panik bei Anlegern auslösen können und hätte dazu führen können, dass möglicherweise kleinere Banken dadurch ruiniert werden und dass dadurch die Machtkonzentration auf dem Bankenmarkt sich vergrößert. Als die Behörde dann interveniert hat, haben diese Banken dann aufgehört, sich in den Wahlkampf einzumischen. Can you mention other examples which are publicly known when you have intervened?
Oh yeah. For example, we had so far in 11 months of existence, we had deployed 14 international workshops with a specific emphasis in the study, the detailed study of the productive processes, the different sectorial situations, in order to detect where are the specific abuses of market power, but also in order to discuss with the academia, with the enterprises and the public sector, which are the potential solutions to the problems. And as a result of this, we end up, for example, in a very detailed analysis with the nitty-gritties of the technical dynamics in the IT sector, everything related to internet, cellular phones, etc., etc. And out of that discussion, we had the possibility to create a public conscience about the study that we had already finished before the workshop about the monopolization on behalf of one of the operators of the most strategic sites in the Ecuadorian topography. They had monopolized the installation of antennas there and other devices indispensable for having a good signal and good coverage. And that had created a much higher cost for the rest of the operators. and with a very uncertain result in terms of the quality of the service. So we issued a precautionary measure in order to suspend any clause of exclusivity in the contracts of renting of those terrains with some strategic characteristics upon the Ecuadorian orography, and that had opened the doors for a renegotiation of the whole operation of the mobile phone industry in Ecuador in terms of better quality and lower costs for the consumer.
Ja, es gab 14 internationale Workshops, auf verschiedene Wirtschaftssektoren bezogen mit Betrachtung des produktiven Prozesses und in den verschiedenen Sektoren. Und dazu gab es Diskussionen mit der Wissenschaft, mit dem öffentlichen Sektor, mit den Unternehmen. Es wurde eine Studie veröffentlicht zum abgekürzt ITT-Sektor, es umfasst Mobiltelefone ebenso wie das Internet und dortige Machtkonzentration. Dabei stellte sich heraus, dass eine Firma eine monopolartige Stellung hatte auf dem Bereich von Antennen und von anderen Geräten oder Bauteilen, die man braucht für vernünftigen Empfang. Und das schuf natürlich höhere Kosten für die Konkurrenten und weniger Qualitätswettbewerb, als er hätte sein können. Darauf hat die Superintendencia del Control del Poder del Mercado reagiert, indem sie vorsorgliche Maßnahmen gemacht hat, dafür gesorgt hat, dass Exklusivverträge vermieden wurden bzw. wieder geöffnet werden mussten, um da Wettbewerb zu schaffen.
If I may complement the idea, the point is that the major achievement so far has been the visibilization of the whole realm of rights that was hidden for the population. People, even the enterprises, believe that abuses in the realm of business were natural. And we had succeeded in positing the idea that nobody has to accept abuses from anybody in any dimension of the social life. And that has been very important. But at the same time, that has discovered a new aspect of the Ecuadorian society that was not perceived by the society, nor by the scholars, not even by the scholars. And this new aspect is related to the climate of fear in the business sector. People, once these new realms, these new rights, these new dimensions of the law and the constitutional rights has been discovered and visibilized, are willing to complain about the infractions, the violations of the law. But very few people, very few operators are willing to present a formal denunciation because of fear, because they are frightened about the possibilities of reprisal, about the retaliations on behalf of the bigger enterprises. And this is characteristic, this typifies in a very deep way the type of structures of power, the type of structural asymmetry that is at the core of the processes of poverty generation and underdevelopment.
Die Superintendenz der Control del Poder del Mercado hat ganze Reihe von Rechten wieder in die Hände der Bürger gegeben und viele Unternehmen hatten ja gar kein Bewusstsein, dachten, es wäre normal, Marktmacht zu missbrauchen. Und da hat ein starker Bewusstseinswandel stattgefunden, dass niemand es sich gefallen lassen muss, wenn Marktmacht missbraucht wird. Und was aber immer noch zu beobachten ist, ist, dass in der Wirtschaft benachteiligte Unternehmen sich nicht unbedingt trauen, sich an die Behörde zu wenden, weil sie eben befürchten, dass größere Konkurrenten sich an ihnen rächen können. Ökonomisch. I would like to ask, are you also active in power concentration regarding the media sector?
Yes, it's not our main concern because there is another institutionality. Even the new law recently approved is has created a superintendency of communications, a superintendency with related to the media in general. But yes, we are also in charge of the supervision of the enforcement and the enforcement of the dispositions of the new constitution about the linking between the ownership structure of the banking sector with respect to the media, because of the very pernicious, very nefarious experience during the financial crisis between 1998 and 2001, in which a biased publicity, biased news approach created a distorted idea of what was going on in terms of the financial sector, and the collapse of the banks ended up with billionaire bankers in Miami to the cost of the savers all around the country, including people that lost the savings of the whole life. And this dichotomy between bankrupt banks and millionaire bankers in Miami without the possibility of extradition facing the penal demands had created a very bitter conscience in Ecuador with respect to the combination of market power and media power, specifically related to the lies that and the level of fraud that could be created in a very easy way with very dire consequences.
Ecuador hat von 1998 bis 2001, ich hatte danach gefragt, ob die Behörde von Herrn Dr. Faes auch zuständig ist für den Mediensektor. Ja, das ist sie, obwohl es für die Beaufsichtigung der Medien als solche, also die eigentliche Arbeit der Medien, inzwischen eine neue Medienaufsichtsbehörde gibt, aber im wirtschaftlichen Bereich eben. Und wichtig ist, sich anzuschauen, wem die Medien gehören. Und 1998 bis 2001 hat Ecuador bittere Erfahrungen gemacht damit, als während der dortigen Finanzkrise man gesehen hat, welche Auswirkungen es haben kann, wenn zum Beispiel Banken und Medien in der gleichen Hand sind, während einer Finanzkrise, und wie dann die Nachrichtenlage, die Information der Bevölkerung ist. Während der Finanzkrise in Ecuador haben sich Ergebnisse herausgestellt, dass Milliardäre sich abgesetzt haben nach Miami und Sparer die Ersparnisse ihres Lebens verloren haben, als Banken insolvent geworden sind. Und aus dieser bitteren Erfahrung hat man gelernt, diese Kombination zwischen Marktmacht und Medienmacht und vor allem eben Macht von Banken und Medienmacht in einer Hand jeweils. I would like to come to the issue about the Banco del Sur. We have learned that you have an important role regarding the vision of the Banco del Sur?
Yeah, I was very active in the technical design of the new features of Banco del Sur, the new development bank for the Latin American integration, that is at the same time a new type of banking, a new type of development bank and infrastructure bank, but also is the bank for a new type of development. And we had to deploy the efforts to set up the discussion, the debate in Latin America about the axiological and epistemological challenges that involved.
Herr Dr. Paez, ich habe übergeleitet zur Frage zur Banco del Sur. Wir haben gehört, dass er sehr involviert ist in die Vision, diese Bank zu schaffen, und er ist sehr aktiv in den technischen Fragen zur Schaffung dieser Bank. Und es handelt sich um eine neuartige Art von Entwicklungsbank, aber es geht auch um neuartige Entwicklung, die diese Bank schaffen will. What is new regarding the type of this bank, and what is new about the kind of development it is going to create?
Let's start with the new type of development that the new bank pursue from the perspective of the Ecuadorian proposal. We succeeded in achieving the signature of seven presidents of Latin America in December 2007 around the main priorities, regardless the criteria of efficiency between quotes, regardless the criteria of the market viability and the capture, the epistemological and technical capture of the functioning of the current commercial and even development and public banks in Latin America. And the priorities have been set in terms of a new concept of supranational sovereignty, a very different situation than in Europe, in which you had imposed yourselves a situation in which the construction of the supranational dimension requires the sacrifice of the national sovereignty. In the case of Latin America, the discussion, the technical discussion, had made possible the compatibility between both. More so is a type of synergy in which the enlargement, the improvement of the policy space at the national level is directly related to the deployment of popular subnational sovereignty in terms of empowerment of the communities from the territory, but also the construction of a new dimension, a new capability of decision at the supranational continental level. That is the spirit and the concept behind the design of the new regional financial architecture, not only Bank of the South, but also the alternative currency, the alternative common currency, not exclusive like in the case of the euro, that in Latin America is called Sucre, the regional system of settlements that is already operating among the ALBA countries, and the regional alternative to the IMF, the Fondo del Sur. Okay. So within the priorities of financing of the new type of development, Bank of the South, are continental sovereignty in terms of food, in terms of healthcare, in terms of energy, in terms of knowledge production, in terms of natural resources, in terms of infrastructure, connectivity infrastructure specifically, not related only to the market, to the export markets, but to the provocation of regional domestic markets within the continent in order to reduce our dependency of with respect to the north, but also and finally sovereignty, continental sovereignty in terms of the funding of other type of productive logics that are not necessarily capitalist. That means to go beyond the type of productive units whose main purpose is accumulation by accumulation or profit by the sake of profit itself. Our idea is to create the adequate financial and non-financial products in order to promote other type of economy, like the popular, the solidary economy, with the indigenous communities, the cooperatives, the self-employment mechanisms, the small and medium-sized enterprises.
Ja, es geht. Ich habe, Moment. Ja, es geht darum, ich hatte gefragt, was ist denn neu an dieser Art von Bank und was ist neu an der Entwicklung, die sie schaffen soll? Es ist eine supranationale Bank, also eben auf der internationalen Ebene. Und es ist ein anderer Ansatz zu dem Wort Supranationalität als bei der EU. Es geht nicht darum, die Souveränität der Staaten dorthin abzugeben, sondern es geht da mehr um Gleichgewicht, dass es sich ergänzt, das miteinander in Einklang zu bringen, also eine gemeinsame supranationale Ebene zu haben, aber auf eine Art und Weise, die eben die souveräne Ebene der Staaten nicht schwächt, sondern dass beides miteinander vereinbar ist. Die Bank des Südens ist eine Entwicklungsbank, Banco del Sur, und sie ist zusammenzusehen mit verschiedenen Projekten, zum Beispiel die alternative gemeinsame Währung Sucre. Das ist diese Verrechnungseinheit wird schon benutzt, zum Beispiel zwischen den Alba-Ländern wird sie benutzt und Fondo del Sur. Fondo del Sur ist ein lateinamerikanisches Gegenstück, Konkurrenz zum Internationalen Währungsfonds. Was man finanzieren will, ist Souveränität auf dem Kontinent bezüglich Ernährung, Gesundheit, Infrastruktur. Infrastruktur in dem Sinne, vor allem was Verbindungen angeht, dann Energieversorgung und ein Fokus soll sein auf den heimischen Märkten, also auf den Märkten des Kontinents und weniger als bisher, soll nicht mehr so sehr wie bisher eine Exportabhängigkeit in andere Teile der Erde bestehen. Wirtschaftlich geht es auch darum, über Profit als Selbstzweck hinauszugehen und solidarische Ökonomie aufzubauen, am Volk orientierte solidarische Ökonomie, dem auch den indigenen Gemeinschaften, aber auch kleinen und mittelständischen Unternehmen mehr nutzt als bisher. What do you think are the most important differences in comparison to the World Bank in order to achieve promoting another kind, a more social kind of economy?
Yeah, there are several dimensions. The most important is related to the idea of development in terms of the IMF and the World Bank. The epistemological core is related to the general equilibrium theory and the so-called free market doctrine, the British doctrine of free market, in which the comparative advantages and the total openness of the economy was supposed to solve all the problems. The structural crisis that we are living now is a very clear indication of the the moral and the theoretical bankruptcy of this type of school of thought. You have the other alternatives precisely related to the overcoming, the surpassing of the general equilibrium theory, the hypothesis of efficient markets, and all the type of all the components of the neoclassical school of thought. We are trying to create other technical criteria, for example, related to the banking practices that could include, that could internalize, for example, the environmental and the social externalities that are not considered in the normal projects, in the normal evaluation and prioritization of the financial processes. We value very much the unpaid work of women and the families within the communities. We value very much the perspective of social profitability rather than the commercial profitability, pecuniary profitability. And that changed completely the type of functioning of the bank. But also we have a lot of innovations in terms of governance. A very important part of of the real task of the IMF and the World Bank is the expropriation of sovereignty through the cross-conditionality. We are proposing, in the case of Banco del Sur and the new regional financial architecture, the subordination of these financial institutions to the democratically elected political power. That means that it is not for the bank to decide which are the priorities and which are the projects that should be financed. It is for the council, the respective council of the ministers of UNASUR, the Union of South American Republics, who has to decide which are the priorities, which are the projects, which are the segments that should be financed in each country. And the task of Banco del Sur is to create the financial conditions to make it viable. Most in the model of the end of the 19th century Renanian investment banks that made possible the unification and the industrialization of countries like Germany or Italy.
Just one, can you repeat which kind of investment banks from the 19th century?
The investment banks that you had in the Rhine, in the continental Europe, that made it possible the rapid industrialization of Germany and Italy with a new technological paradigm linked to electricity, siderurgic high furnaces, etc.
Okay. Ja, ich hatte gefragt, was sind denn die wichtigsten Unterschiede auch zu IWF und Weltbank? Und ja, IWF und Weltbank haben so die Folgen der Vorstellung der wettbewerbsmäßigen Vorteile und dass die Wirtschaft immer offen sein müsste für Weltmarkt, also total freie Märkte. Und es gibt ja auch neoklassische Theorien darüber, ob die Märkte funktionieren. Zumindest das jetzt vor dem IWF und Weltbank folgen. Das da hat die gegenwärtige Wirtschaftskrise moralischen und wirtschaftlichen Bankrott dieser Konzepte gezeigt. Die Banco del Sur verfolgt andere Konzepte. Es geht um weitere neue Kriterien, zum Beispiel ja, Dinge, die in dem bisher in der Wirtschaft externe Effekte sind, zu internalisieren, vor allem soziale und zum Beispiel im Bankensektor soziale und ökologische Folgen in die Wirtschaft zu internalisieren, die Kosten, die dort verursacht werden. Es geht darum, Profitabilität nicht nur ökonomisch zu messen und zu sehen, sondern auch es geht auch um soziale Profitabilität. Es geht um Wertschätzung auch unbezahlter Arbeit, die zum Beispiel in den Familien geleistet wird. und dementsprechend auch wirtschaftlich zu handeln. IWF und Weltbank ist eben nicht nur diese, dass sie bestimmte Theorien haben, die haben auch als wirkliche als einen wirklichen Inhalt, was sie anstreben, die Souveränität der Staaten eher zu schwächen, die Souveränität praktisch bis zu einem gewissen Grad wegzunehmen. Und bei der Banco del Sur geht das anders. Da entscheidet der Ministerrat von den Ministern von UNASUR darüber, welche Schwerpunkte diese Bank sich setzt, welche Projekte gefördert werden. Es ist also viel stärkere demokratische Kontrolle, die wichtigen Entscheidungen gibt. Und es könnte auch in die Richtung gehen, wie im 19. Jahrhundert, da gab es Investmentbanken, die zum Beispiel die technologische Entwicklung in Deutschland oder in Italien vorangebracht haben. Also eine ganz andere Richtung als bei IWF und Weltbank. In which countries is the Banco del Sur going to finance projects? In the UNASUR countries?
Yeah, the idea is to have a financial instrument for a new type of Latin American integration. So far, we have 7 countries involved in the construction of Banco del Sur: Brazil, Argentina, Venezuela, Uruguay, Paraguay, Bolivia, and Ecuador. But only 5 of them had already the ratification of the respective legislature. We are still waiting for the ratification of Brazil and Paraguay. However, the Ecuadorian proposal is to start with such kind of projects that could create the political conditions for the rapid incorporation of other countries that could make possible the Latin American integration. For example, I mentioned that one of the already decided priorities is related to a new type of infrastructure. The illustration is, for example, a network of railroads for Latin America. And the question is very clear. Once we started with the real discussion about the implementation of this network of connectivity for domestic and regional markets in the continent, do you believe that it is possible that a country with a right-wing government like the Colombian one could allow itself to remain isolated for this type of infrastructure? It is possible for a country with like Chile or like Peru to stay a part of this type of initiatives? It is possible for the rest of Latin America, that means the Central American and Mexico, to remain isolated with respect to this new horizon of integration? And precisely that is the vector that we had introduced in the political and diplomatic debate in Latin America. It is possible to have some qualitative leaps with respect to the previous history of integration, precisely because of the new possibilities that the Banco del Sur and the new financial architecture opens for the negotiation among our countries.
Moment, es ging mir um die Frage, in welchen Ländern soll die Banco del Sur Projekte finanzieren? Die Vision ist ja, dass es für ganz Südamerika sein soll. Und bisher sind es 7 Länder, die bei der Banco del Sur dabei sind. Brasilien, Argentinien, Uruguay, Ecuador, Venezuela, Paraguay und Bolivien, wovon allerdings Brasilien und Paraguay noch nicht alles ratifiziert haben, alle vertraglichen Grundlagen. Und Ja, es geht jetzt wieder um den Vorschlag von Ecuador. Und zwar schlägt Ecuador vor oder will vorschlagen, solche Projekte zu fördern, die es ermöglichen, zügig voranzukommen mit dem Beitritt weiterer Länder zur Banco del Sur. Und da scheint vor allem Projekte, die für Straßenverbindungen sinnvoll zu sein. Und wenn man die Märkte besser miteinander verbindet, dann werden auch weitere wichtige Volkswirtschaften wie Kolumbien, wie Chile, wie Mexiko nicht abseits stehen wollen und werden auch an diesem Projekt und diesen neuen Horizonten, die dieses Projekt bietet, teilhaben wollen. I would I'd like to ask as a launch of the Banco del Sur, are they going to be connected with any political conditionalities?
No, as I mentioned, our idea, at least the Ecuadorian proposal, is to refuse any type of conditionalities beyond the technical ones, because the idea is that the negotiation about the priority and the viability of the projects should be a responsibility of the higher levels of UNASUR. That means the sectoral authorities, the sectoral democratically elected authorities at the level of the ministries of each country composing the respective councils. No, it's not for the bank to decide which kind of political conditionalities. It's for the will of the people expressed through the democratically elected governments that had to be negotiated in the framework of the new instance of integration called UNASUR.
Ich hatte gefragt, ob die Banco del Sur auch politische Konditionalitäten haben soll, wie zum Beispiel die Weltbank. Aber wie schon gesagt von Herrn Dr. Paez, ist die Entscheidung treffen ja dann die gewählten Minister in dem von den UNASUR-Ländern. Und da ist kein Raum, dass die Banco del Sur politische Vorgaben machen würde. Das Einzige, was es dann gibt, ist eben wie bei anderen Darlehen auch eben technische Vorgaben, die das Darlehen betreffen, aber keine politischen Vorgaben. Many thanks for taking your time for the interview.
No, thank you very much. I'm very glad to be here, and I'm available for any ulterior conversation with you. Danke schön.
Danke. Hier ist der zweite Teil der Sendung Macht und Menschenrechte, Power and Human Rights auf Jungle Drum Radio. Mein Name ist Volker Reusing. Es ist Donnerstag, der 15. August 2013. Nun begrüße ich den amerikanischen Filmemacher Ace Baker. Hello, Mr. Baker.
Hello, thanks for having me on.
You have produced the great American Psy Opera on the events of 9/11. What do you think are the most important news pieces of reporting on 9/11 with decisive errors on what happened with the World Trade Center buildings?
Well, I think the some of the most important news pieces are the airplane videos, because as I show in my film, the airplane videos are fake. They have to be fake videos. Some other important pieces, I think, are the fact that the official story of 9/11 came out immediately, and which means that the official story had to have been prepared in advance, because if what happened on 9/11 was really a big surprise, then the news media people couldn't have the story together the way that they had it. And if you just watch and listen to the news clips, they already figured out that Osama bin Laden was the guy that did it within just a few minutes of it happening. There are one of the glaring mistakes or errors was when they announced the collapse of Building 7 before it even happened. Now, that, of course, happened on the BBC news, and a reporter named Jane Stanley is standing, in front, and you can see the Building 7, standing behind her, and she announces that it's collapsed. So I think the mistakes in the airplane videos and that announcing Building 7 collapsing before it happened were some pretty glaring mistakes.
Ja, ich hatte Herrn Baker gefragt. Er hat den Dokumentarfilm The Great American Psy Opera gedreht über die Ereignisse von 9/11. Was die größten Fehler sind, die meistgrößten Fehler in der Berichterstattung bei 9/11 und bezüglich World Trade Center. Ja, einmal die gefälschten Videos mit den Flugzeugen. Dann das Gebäude Nummer 7 bei der BBC wurde berichtet, etliche Minuten bevor es zusammenbrach, dass World Trade Center Nummer 7 schon zusammengebrochen sei. Und man sah hinter dem Reporter, dass das Gebäude immer noch, der Reporter und das immer noch stand. Ebenfalls, was nicht stimmen kann, ist die offizielle Geschichte, dass man so schnell auf Osama bin Laden kommt. Also praktisch, während man noch die Katastrophenbilder gezeigt hat, in der Zeit so schnell kann niemand herausgefunden haben, ob Osama bin Laden dahinter steckte. Das kann man nicht zeitgleich machen, da müssen Nachrichten vorbereitet worden sein. What do you mean about that the airplane videos are faked? How can we see it that they are faked?
Right. I mean, I go through a lot of that evidence in my film, The Great American Psy Opera. one of the most obvious things that is fake, if you look at a particular video called Chopper 5, the nose of the airplane appears to pop out of the backside of the building after the plane crashes, and it's impossible for the nose of an airplane to really go all the way through a steel and concrete building because it's hollow and it's made out of plastic. So while that's impossible to have happened in real life, That's exactly the kind of problem that you would have maybe in trying to do a live video composite, which is how they had to fake these airplane videos. They took real footage and inserted a fake airplane, you know, a computer graphics airplane into it. So the nose out in Chopper 5 is one big mistake. When you look at many of the videos, like Fairbanks video and the Hezirconi video, you see the airplane going into the tower, but you don't see any part of the airplane breaking. You don't see any part of the building breaking. Nothing bends or twists. No part of the airplane bounces off or shows any kind of physics at all. You just see an airplane that glides effortlessly into the side of the tower. It shows no physics at all. So it looks very, you know, all of the airplane videos look very fake for that reason. There are also some other mistakes when you compare the Hezirconi video to the Fairbanks video. You'll see there's a particular puff of smoke that appears below the wing in one video and above the wing in another video, which would be impossible in real life, but it has a very simple, easy explanation in video effects. They simply got a layer mask in the wrong place. And I go and explain that and show that how that works technically in chapter 7 of my film. So, and there are a number of other things too, but the bottom line is that the 9/11 airplane videos look fake because they are fake.
Ja, ich hatte gefragt nach den 9/11 Videos, wie er darauf kommt, woran er gesehen hat, dass die Flugzeugszenen gefälscht seien. Da gibt es zum Beispiel ganz reale Videoaufnahmen aus dem Helikopter Nummer 5 und die gemischt sind mit einer Computergrafik von einem Flugzeug. Und dadurch ist es passiert, durch Versehen, man hat eben Live-Videoaufnahmen mit dieser Computergrafik gemischt und durch ein Versehen schaut die Nase von dem Flugzeug auf der anderen Seite aus dem Hochhaus zum World Trade Center heraus, als ob es da einfach durchgeflogen wäre. Und das ist physikalisch nicht möglich. Das ist ja das Gebäude ganz wesentlich aus Stahl und aus Beton. Und dann gibt es andere Videos von Fairbanks und von Hezirconi, wo das Flugzeug in das Gebäude hineinfliegt, aber nichts abbricht, sich nichts verbiegt und auch nichts abprallt, sondern einfach in das Gebäude hineinfliegt, was physikalisch auch nicht möglich ist. Weder vom Gebäude bricht da was ab, noch vom Flugzeug. Und man sieht in einem Video, sieht man Rauch über den Flügeln von dem Flugzeug und in einem anderen Video sieht man Rauch darunter. Es kann nicht beides richtig sein. Das sieht aus, als wenn eine Grafikschablone da falsch angelegt worden ist. What do you think? How can such mistakes happen in mainstream media?
Well, the nose out mistake happened because it was a live video. Now, normally, even live video on the news is delayed. It's the same with radio shows and television shows that are live. They usually delay the signal by about 7 seconds so that if anything is said or seen that they don't want going out over the air, they have a few seconds to hit a button and dump out of delay and bypass the thing that they don't want to be seen or heard. However, on 9/11, they had to go completely live without a delay. And that's because they wanted to have people on the phone supposedly witnessing an airplane crash from their windows of their apartments. But what they really were doing was watching television to see the image of the second airplane. And so they could then say, oh my God, I just saw an airplane crash into the tower. Now, if the broadcast had been delayed as it normally would be, well, then these people on the phone would be out of sync. Their comments would not be on time. So that's why they had to go completely live with no delay. And so that's what explains how the nose out mistake made it onto the air. Some of the other mistakes, like the over-under puffball, maybe it was just a mistake because those were in edited videos that were not shown live that came out later. Maybe they were just human mistakes that were made, or maybe the person who did the editing was leaving a mistake on purpose as a clue. I don't know. But, you know, so mistakes can happen. I think actually while we're talking about mistakes, one of the other things that we saw on 9/11 that we were not supposed to see was this molten metal that was pouring out of the South Tower just a few minutes before it was blown up. There's something, some kind of metal that's liquid and is bright, almost white in color, like a very bright yellow color, is dripping out of a window of the South Tower. And then just a minute later or so, they demolished that tower. And there's simply no explanation other than some kind of incendiary, some kind of substance up there that gets about 3,000 degrees Fahrenheit. That, you know, there's just simply no innocent explanation. So that's another mistake, that molten metal was dripping out there.
Ja, zu der Frage, wie kann es sein, dass solche Fehler in Massenmedien zu sehen sind? Normalerweise ist es so, dass man ungefähr 7 Sekunden Verzögerung hat bei einer Sendung. Aber man wollte offenbar Leute haben, die wirklich live am Telefon sind und sagen, was sie sehen. Und wenn sie das berichten, was sie im Fernsehen sehen. Und aufgeregte Leute wollte man am Telefon haben und deswegen konnte man die 7 Sekunden Verzögerung nicht machen. Und so konnte es passieren, dass zum Beispiel der Fehler von Helikopter 5 mit der herausschauenden Flugzeugnase zu sehen war. Sonst hätte man mit 7 Sekunden Verzögerung hätte man das verhindern können, dass das gesendet wird. Es kann sein, dass es Versehen gewesen sind. Vielleicht haben auch Leute, die da involviert gewesen sind, absichtlich solche Fehler zu sehen waren, um einen Hinweis zu geben. Aber darüber kann man hier an dieser Stelle jetzt nur spekulieren. Ein Fehler ist auch, dass man da ein geschmolzenes Material sieht. Bei einem Fenster aus dem Südturm, helles Gelb, fast weiß, geschmolzenes Metall. Das würde auf eine Temperatur dort von ungefähr 3000 Grad Fahrenheit hindeuten. Eine Minute, bevor man dann den Südturm gesprengt hat. You mean that is this seemingly molten metal is also fabricated. It's also computer graphic.
Oh, no, no. In fact, it has to be real because we saw that happening on live television. And faking something like an airplane is pretty easy because it's an inanimate object. It's just it doesn't have to have a lot of complex animation. But no, something like dripping molten metal would be very, very difficult to animate. No, the molten metal was very, very real. And what I suspect that molten metal was about, actually, was that it appears to come from the place in the South Tower, right where a bunch of the airplane wreckage would have landed, and right where a big piece of the airplane crashed.
Das mit dem geschmolzenen Metall, das sieht, da habe ich falsch verstanden, das sieht sehr real aus. Das ist sehr schwierig zu animieren. Sorry, I didn't get the last sentences.
Neighborhood. I'm sorry.
Hallo? Und I'm sorry, moment. At the moment, I can't hear you.
Cannon that fired that object out to create the impression that one of the engines was penetrating all the way through the tower and flying out the other side. But then before they demolished the tower, they needed to melt down that cannon because, of course, if the cannon went flying out and we saw a giant cannon, you know, flying through the air, everyone would go, wait a minute, why is there a giant cannon flying out of the South Tower as it's blowing up? So I think they had to melt that down so that we didn't see it. And unfortunately, as they were melting that with something like thermite or some kind of heavy-duty incendiary, something that can generate temperatures of 3,000 degrees or more, enough to melt steel, unfortunately, a bunch of that molten metal came dripping out of the South Tower, and we saw it.
I'm sorry that we have, I have for a short moment, maybe half a minute, I have been disconnected from what you have said. It has been a technical problem. I'm sorry. As I have understood, is that one wanted to create the impression that there has been a part of the of the plane inside the building, and what did one want to hide by and what caused this this melting steel? Can you repeat? I'm sorry.
Yeah, I believe that there was a cannon, a big military, like an old Navy cannon. Because the place where we see that molten metal dripping out is the exact spot where it appeared that part of the airplane shot out of the backside of the tower, maybe one of the engines of the airplane. And so I believe that they actually had a cannon up there in that tower and fired an airplane engine out of the backside to make us think that it had penetrated all the way through the tower and flown out the backside. However, I think that it was then necessary to melt that cannon to get rid of it because they knew they were going to blow up the tower in a few minutes, and it could very easily throw that cannon out into the air where it would be seen. And we'd all go, what is a cannon doing up there in the South Tower? So I believe they melted it down, and unfortunately, we saw the molten metal dripping out of the tower, which, again, has no innocent explanation at all.
Yeah. Also es ging darum, Herr Baker vermutet, dass man vorhatte, so aussehen zu lassen, als ob ein Motor vom Flugzeug auf der anderen Seite, wo das Flugzeug in den Südturm hineingecrasht sein sollte, dass man auf der entgegengesetzten Seite dann ein Motor vom Flugzeug herauskommen sollte, um diesen Eindruck zu erwecken, dass man da mit einer Art Kanone innerhalb des Gebäudes geschossen hat und dass man diese wiederum, da, wenn das Gebäude zusammenfallen würde, dass die Leute nicht sehen, dass dass sie dort vorhanden ist, dass man die deswegen dann geschmolzen hat und dass das dann zu sehen war. There's no airplane which has crashed into the towers. And if I look at your film, I want to believe that it has been made by computer graphics. But how do you then explain the passenger lists of the hijacked planes and the mobile phone calls from there?
Right. The passenger lists were published on, I believe it was CNN's website, just a few days after 9/11. And one of the very interesting things about those passenger lists is that none of the supposed hijackers were on those lists. So, if we're to believe the official story, we have to believe that those hijackers somehow got on those airplanes without buying tickets, which is very, very difficult to believe. But I think that all four of those airplane flights really did happen. They all took off as advertised, and those people who were passengers on the plane really were passengers on the plane. And I think that all four planes really were hijacked, of course, not by the Arab terrorists that we were told hijacked the plane, but probably by some kind of military special operations guys. And then the airplanes were all landed. For example, the two Boston, the two flights that took off out of Boston were probably landed at a place called Stewart Air Force Base, which is in New York State, just north of New York City. And I think that because the radar track of both of those flights goes directly over Stewart Air Force Base. And in fact, both of the flights supposedly crossed over Stewart Air Force Base at exactly the same time, which is extremely unlikely to have happened by chance. Now, we know that on 9/11, they were injecting false radar blips into the radar screens of the air traffic controllers, supposedly as part of a war games that were coincidentally taking place on 9/11. So I think what they did is the real flights landed and then were replaced on radar by the fake radar blips, which then continued on to the supposed destinations. And then as far as the passenger phone calls, as far as I know, there's only one recording of a phone call, and that was by flight attendant Betty Ong, who was a flight attendant on Flight 11, which supposedly crashed into the North Tower. And that phone call took place fairly early on, shortly after the hijacking. So I believe that was a real phone call that really was recorded. And she really thought they were being hijacked because they really were. It was before the plane landed at Stewart Air Force Base. All of the rest of the supposed phone calls, I say, what phone calls? None of the other ones were recorded. We have transcripts that were supposedly written down, but I just don't know why I should believe that any of those other phone calls even took place. You know, what phone calls?
Ja, also zu den Passagierlisten, die sind wenige Tage später bei CNN veröffentlicht worden. Und keine von den Passagierlisten enthielt auch nur einen einzigen Namen der angeblichen Entführer der Flugzeuge. Und es ist sehr unwahrscheinlich, dass keiner der Flugzeugentführer der angeblichen, dass kein einziger von denen ein Ticket gekauft hat. Und ja, dann gibt es die Frage vom falschen Radarbildern. Es ist ja am gleichen Tag auch eine Simulation gemacht worden, also eine Übung. Und ob da falsche Radarbilder, also Radarbilder von dieser Übung gezeigt worden sind. Ein Teil der Flugzeuge scheint auch dann ihr Ziel erreicht zu haben. Die aufgezeichneten Gespräche, also die meisten Gespräche gibt es nur aufgezeichnet auf Papier und nur eins ist als Tondokument aufgezeichnet und das scheint relativ kurz nach der angeblichen Entführung schon aufgenommen worden zu sein, vom Flug Nummer 11, der angeblich in den Nordturm gecrasht sein soll. Can you just only repeat... What has become of the airplanes, which have landed on where they were supposed to land?
Right, I think that two of the flights landed at Stewart Air Force Base in New York. I think the third plane, I think, landed at Cleveland at the NASA facility, which, by the way, is something very interesting that was, I think, figured out by Dylan Avery in his film Loose Change, the very original, the very first version of Loose Change, noted that that Flight 93 was reported in the news to have landed near Cleveland, and the radar tracks it all the way up to Cleveland. And then the fourth flight, 77, that supposedly crashed into the Pentagon, flew way, way west and then came way back east for a long time, was flying around for almost 2 hours, I think. And it could have landed at any number of little landing strips along the way. So I'm sure that the passengers and crew were killed at these secret locations, and then they probably took blood samples and so forth and brought those samples to the supposed crash sites like the Pentagon and the Twin Towers and Shanksville, Pennsylvania, and left those bits around so that they then could collect that evidence and do DNA testing. And so the DNA testing then was perfectly legitimate. I'm sure it was able to match up with those people. And you know, I'm sure they just took the airplanes and took them apart and disposed of them.
Ja, zwei der Flüge vermutet Herr Baker, dass sie bei Stewart Air Force Basis bei New York gelandet sind. Der Flug 93 soll, da bezieht er sich auf den Film Loose Change, in Cleveland gelandet sein. Und da gäbe es auch entsprechend über Radarbilder berichtet worden sein. Dazu und Flug Nummer 77, der sei relativ weit nach Westen und hinterher wieder in östlicher Richtung geflogen. Er könnte an vielen Stellen gelandet sein, der angeblich in das Pentagon gecrasht sein soll. Und da, wo eine angebliche Absturzstelle eines Flugzeugs gewesen sein soll und auch beim Pentagon, soweit man da Spuren vom Blut gefunden hat, kann man das auch woanders das Blut an anderer Stelle bekommen haben, das und dann dorthin gebracht haben, um scheinbar Beweise zu fabrizieren.